I will begin. Introduce myself quickly. My name is Karen Butler. I was associate curator at the Kemper Art Museum. I left and relocated to San Diego in May. But the exhibition on view, World War I Images of War, War of Images, was my last project here. And so I opened it in September, and I'm delighted to be back here for our last visit and to introduce our distinguished speaker for tonight, Professor Dr. Thomas Gaetghens. So I have a little bit of an introduction. First, welcome everyone. It's a wonderful, beautiful evening, and we're so pleased you could join us. And also welcome to Professor Gaetghens, who is director at the Getty Research Institute. His talk, titled Bombing the Reims Cathedral, builds on themes in the exhibition World War I, War of Images, Images of War, now on view in the Kemper Art Museum. I hope you've all had a chance to see it, or will do so. It closes in January. Before I introduce Professor Gaetghens, let me say a bit about the exhibition, which I hope that most of you have had the opportunity to visit. The exhibition was organized by the Getty Research Institute, where it first opened in November 2014, on the 100th anniversary of the beginning of World War I. It presents a unique investigation of the art and visual culture of the First World War, examining both the ways in which combatant nations utilized visual propaganda against their enemies, and how individual artists developed their own visual language to convey and cope with the horrors they witnessed. Divided into three sections, the exhibition charts a path chronologically through the war, from the exuberant beginnings, when artists often voluntarily enlisted and sometimes celebrated the violence of the war in their work, to its traumatic aftermath. The works in the show are drawn primarily from the special collections at the Getty Research Institute, a very deep and wide collection. And it includes as well key loans from major public institutions across the country. In St. Louis, the exhibition has been supplemented with paintings from several public and private collections, including the Kemper Art Museum's permanent collection, and I'm very grateful to all the collectors and donors who loaned those works. And I am particularly grateful to Professor Gaetghens for his help in bringing this show to Washington University, where the interdisciplinary nature of the materials has had particular resonance with the broader university community as well as the general public. I'll share one brief anecdote. I overheard this afternoon one of our young educators. She came into the office full of excitement after having held a conversation in Italian with an Italian class about the content of the show. So we're really reaching out and interacting with the university in different ways. And now for Professor Gaetghens. It's quite a distinguished career. He received his doctorate in 1966 at the Institute of Art History at the Universität Bonn, and his habilitation in 1972 at the Universität Göttingen. He was in 1979 at the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton. Between 1980 and 2006, he served as professor at the Freie Universität in Berlin. He was a Getty Scholar at the J. Paul Getty Center for the History of Art and the Humanities from 1985 to 86. In 1992, he organized the 26th International Congress of Art History in Berlin and served as the president of the Comité International d'Histoire de l'Art from 1992 to 1996. He taught at the Collège de France in 1995 and held the position of European Chair at the Collège de France between 1998 and 1999. He was director of the Deutsches Forum für Kunstgeschichte, Centre Allemand d'Histoire de l'Art in Paris, an organization he founded in 1997. In 2004, he received an honorary doctorate at the Courtauld Institute of Art. Since 2007, he has been the director at the Getty Research Institute in Los Angeles. He was awarded the Grand Prix de l'Académie Française pour la Francophonie in 2009. In 2011, he received an honorary doctorate from the Paris Sorbonne, and was elected a fellow in the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. In recognition of his scholarship, he was awarded the Prix Mondial Sino del Duca in 2015 by the Institut de France. And his research interests include 18th to 20th century French and German art history, as well as the history of the museum, although I will say that we also spoke about American art of the 18th and 19th century, and Marston Hartley, so an enormous breadth of interest in the history of art. I apologize in advance as I get to the publications, because many of them are in German, and my reading German was okay, but my spoken German isn't so good, so just bear with me. In 1984, he published Versailles als Nationaldenkmal. In 1990, Anton von Werner, this is of course only a selection. Anton von Werner, Die Proklamierung des Deutschen Kaiserreichs, ein Historienbild im Wandel Preußischer Politik. In 1992, Die Berliner Museumssinnel, I did have a lesson from Sabina, but this is hard. Die Berliner Museumsinsel im Deutschen Kaiserreich. And then, now we get to the French things, which I'm a little bit better. 1998, with Christophe Pommien, Le 8e siècle, in 1999. L'art sans frontières, Paris-Berlin, les relations artistiques franco-allemandes, and in 2011, L'art, l'histoire, l'histoire de l'art. And of course, there are a wide range of books and articles that he has edited and written in French about French and German history of art from the 18th, 19th, and 20th centuries. So, welcome.
Good evening, and thank you very much, Kate, for this lovely introduction. Some of you, ladies and gentlemen, might have seen in the exhibition the image of the burning Cathedral of Reims. Why would the attack on this monument merit an entire lecture? Of course, we all deplore the destruction of cultural heritage, which is usually caused by vandalism or wars. But why is the shelling of the Cathedral of Reims by German bombs in 1914 such a significant moment in history that it requires special efforts of historical investigation and interpretation? I hope to demonstrate that this event has to be understood as crucial in the long and controversial history of political and cultural relations between Germany and France. The shelling of the cathedral so infuriated the Allies of World War I that from that moment on the war became a way to humiliate and destroy the other, especially in case of France and Germany. Understanding, compromise, or at least respect between the nations would remain impossible for many years to come. This lecture is much less dedicated to the event itself, but rather to its context. It will try to explain how a fragile relationship between neighboring countries suddenly exploded at a moment of intense tension when the sensibility of the people was at its highest strain. The bombing of Reims Cathedral ignited this situation. It is important in this context to know that at this very moment in early September 1914, it became clear that the military goal of the German army had failed. The Germans not only had to stop their invasion to reach as fast as possible Paris, they had to retreat. The shelling of Reims represented the historical moment when the war changed from a movement forwards to a stalemate in the trenches, in which the enemies had to fight and try to survive for almost 4 years. One of the methodological frameworks of this lecture is to understand that monuments and artworks play major roles in the political arena. They are not only symbols and expressions of political, cultural or religious traditions, but also signify identity, in this case, national identity. Treating these monuments in a disrespectful way by looting or destroying them is an attack on the very heart of a nation and its people. History is full of such perpetrations since the earliest times, and many contemporary examples readily come to mind. One need only to think of Iraq and Syria. One such example, which plays a major symbolic role in political language and imagery until today, is the Cathedral of Reims, where French kings were crowned since the early Middle Ages, and which is, with Chartres and Amiens, one of the classic Gothic masterpieces. The shelling of Reims must be considered in this context. The events in September 1914 at Reims should have awakened European political leaders to the unfolding catastrophe, but they were too weak to change the course of history. The few critical voices against the war fell on deaf ears. The reaction to the shelling of the cathedral, especially in France and Germany, was overwhelming. In commenting on this event, pamphlets and cartoons adopted a humiliating, even brutal style and tone. But instead of reflecting and appealing to question this European disaster, both sides moved stubbornly on into the catastrophe. I will try to shed light on why there was no way to bridge the gaps of understanding. Historical research has not been able to clarify completely what happened in September 1914 and again in 1917 and 1918 in Reims. Maurice Landrieu, a clergyman at the cathedral from 1912 to 16 and later Bishop of Dijon, responded to the official report of the German military. His book, La Cathédrale de Reims, un crime allemand, was published in 1919, but written right after the events in 1915 with a strong national feeling and indignation. Nonetheless, it seems to be a rather reliable source by a witness who actively tried to protect the monument. This publication also contains interesting statistics about the number of bombs that reach the city and the cathedral, as well as rich documentation of photographs, some of which were taken by his colleague, priest Jules Tinot. What prompted the shelling of Reims Cathedral? When the German army arrived outside of Reims, they had sent emissaries into the city. They did not come back immediately, and the Germans believed that they were captured by French troops. In fact, they did not get back and were sent to a camp at Orléans and set free only after the end of the war. The Germans retaliated by shelling the city on September 4th, intending to intimidate the French military and the population. The cathedral was not deliberately targeted, but hit, although not yet heavily damaged. When the first bombs began to fall on September 4th, the vicar, Monseigneur Andrier, and an employé of the city, immediately hoisted a white flag to the northern tower of the cathedral as a sign of surrender and to protect the monument. Shortly after, the French troops retreated and the Germans entered the city and installed their headquarters at the Hotel de Lion d'Or in front of the cathedral. You see here the Prussian army in Reims. The damages at this point were deplorable, but not substantial. The Prussian officer, von Kiesewetter, supposedly stated at this moment, if your beautiful cathedral has virtually not been touched, it is because our bombers received the official order from a higher authority to respect her. This probably is coming from Kaiser Wilhelm II. There is evidence that this order was given. An important decision was reached on September 12th with the regional delegate of the Red Cross. All wounded German officers and soldiers, about 200, should be brought into the cathedral. Against the protests of the clergy, the cathedral was thus converted into a hospital. Bales of straw were brought into the cathedral, covering the floor. The flag of the Red Cross was flown on the northern tower at all times during the next weeks, as French reports stated. The defeat in the Battle at the Marne, fought from September 5th to 12th, forced the Germans to leave Reims so rapidly on the evening of September 12th that they could not take their wounded along. They retreated to the location of their cannons on the hills northeast of Reims and remained there until October 5th, 1918. The French troops re-entered Reims immediately and decided to follow the German plan and keep the wounded Germans in the cathedral, which they hoped would prevent any further bombing of the church. It is today generally acknowledged that the French army gathered very close to the army, to the cathedral. You can see, I hope you can see, here, what is this? You can see that? Okay. The Germans claimed that the French used the protection of the cathedral and had cannons positioned in front of the building. Although the French declined that this was the case, there is some photographic evidence proving that they had cannons close to the portals at the time. There also seems to be agreement today that the French military observed German movements from the cathedral's north tower. Even a spotlight had been brought to the northern tower for observation during the night. The German army used this as the official justification to resume shelling of Reims when heavy fighting began close to the city on September 18. It is unknown whether the German knew that the French had kept the wounded in the cathedral. In any case, they were rapidly relocated during the shelling under guerrilla conditions and not without loss of many human lives. The heaviest shelling took place on September 19, when the cathedral took fire. The fire quickly spread because the north tower was encased in wooden scaffolding and the cathedral's floor was still covered with straw. Photographic documentation captures the extent of the destruction. The building was hit in several places, sculptures were mutilated, and the famous glass windows destroyed. The entire roof burned, greatly devastating the interior of the church. However, not only the cathedral was hit, but the entire city sustained damage. In his book, Landrieux documented in detail where the bombs fell. All these little dots are bombs. Close to the church, as he wanted. In his book, Landrieux documented in detail where the bombs fell close to the church, as he wanted to demonstrate that the German military specifically targeted the cathedral. Although many shells hit the church, the majority caused the destruction of buildings all over the city. His argument is therefore not really convincing. The shelling of Reims Cathedral incited one of the most intense reactions by the international press during World War I. Until now, there has been no thorough study that has analyzed this abundant material. Even A first overview yields several strands of arguments, which, of course, have to be considered as part of the general propagandistic efforts since the beginning of the war. It is clear that the reports and discussion about the advanced bombardment substantially intensified the prevalent animosity. French commentators expressed the view that the shelling finally revealed the true character not only of the military leaders of the German army and the commander-in-chief, Kaiser Wilhelm II, but of German people in general. Many French authors argued that the Germans declared war not only for political reasons, but to destroy French culture. The bombing of a national monument was portrayed as a deliberate act of vandalism. The press adopted a new and extremely aggressive tone. Germans were described as barbarians, vandals, and Huns. This argument has a historical background. After violating Belgian neutrality by entering the country in August of 1914, the German army encountered unexpected resistance by the very courageous Belgian troops and general animosity from the population. The German campaign in Belgium was cruel and entailed abominable war crimes and destructions, initiating a heavy anti-German surge in propaganda. One element became especially important, the claim that the German army deliberately burned down the library at Louvain, resulting in the loss of a highly important collection of rare books and manuscripts, was repeated over and over again. There is no evidence that the German army specifically targeted the library, but it was undoubtedly a result of the hasty and awfully brutal course of action, as inexcusable as all actions nowadays called collateral damage. Precise examination by an international committee of historians have concluded that the killing of innocent inhabitants and the burning of Louvain by the German army were undoubtedly war crimes. The German claim that their army responded to so-called francs-tireurs, or snipers, turned out to be unfounded. German troops were disorganized and their own soldiers were killed by friendly fire. The pretension that the Germans were trying to destroy their neighbor's culture infused the general propagandistic language. A telling example was a famous and influential philosopher, Henri Bergson, who claimed in a speech at the Académie des Sciences Morales et Politiques in Paris on August 8, 1914, that the lutte engagée contre l'Allemagne est la lutte même de la civilisation contre la barbarie. The shelling of the Cathedral of Reims seemed to deliver the final proof of this accusation. The fact that this speech was given before both the invasion of Belgium and the bombardment of Reims illustrates the tension already prevalent between the two nations, which the two events would then bring to an escalation. The counter-propaganda on the German side did not rest either. The German press portrayed commentators from Belgium, France, and other countries as liars who intentionally falsified reports about the events. In the case of Reims, the German press especially discussed the military reports, according to which the French concentrated troops in front of the cathedral and used its towers as observation points. Most historians agree today that this was the case. If so, it would have violated the international laws of war to protect historical monuments internationally accepted by the Hague Conventions of 1907. However, assuming that the Germans thought they were monitored from the tower of the cathedral, they still could have avoided shelling the monument. The argument seems especially weak because observation during the war was much more effective by employing balloons and airplanes. Little could have probably been detected from the cathedral's towers. Whatever the truth is, the bitter debates which ensued in publications, in the press and in visual images reveal an irreconcilable confrontation. The aggressor argued that the French should have done more to protect their monuments and claimed that collateral damages were unavoidable. The defender claimed that the Germans aimed to destroy the monuments in order to humiliate the other culture, demonstrating their real character as barbarians. This acrimonious controversy could be dismissed as typical wartime propaganda. However, we have to investigate deeper to understand the magnitude of the confrontation provoked by the bombing of Reims Cathedral. The event profoundly shocked French intellectuals who, for an important part, had held an intense admiration of German philosophy, literature, music, and art. By relying on press accounts and by even abstracting from the visible propagandistic content, they were unable to interpret the siege of Reims without turning away from their neighbors and German culture in general in disgust. Similarly, the German intelligentsia and bourgeoisie were shocked to find themselves described as Vandals, barbarians, and Huns. Let us take a closer look into the intellectual debates in the two countries. In France, the shelling of Reims occurred in a tense political context of inner conflict. Since the end of the 19th century, the Third Republic struggled with widespread anti-Semitism, which culminated in 1894 with the Dreyfus Affair, which divided the government and the military from an intellectual opposition as well as the Socialist Party. Captain Alfred Dreyfus had been accused and convicted of spying for the Germans, although his innocence became clear. Well, this is from the former, and I will go further. Although his innocence became clear, Dreyfus, a broken man, was only acquitted after 5 years. At the same time, heavy controversies broke out over the separation of church and state, which finally was affirmed by the parliament in 1905. As a result, the state no longer felt responsible for the conservation of religious monuments. An intense debate followed, in which Marcel Proust participated with a famous article called La Mort des Cathédrales, The Death of the Cathedral, published in 1904. One of the most violent politicians and writers engaged in this question was Maurice Barrès. A member of the Conservative Party in the Parliament, he vehemently pleaded in his speeches from 1910, 11, and 12 against the social majority and defended the responsibility of the state for the care of national monuments. He combined these speeches in his extremely popular and heavily discussed book with the telling title La Grande Pitié des Églises de France, published in 1914. The book, in which he lamented the failing conservation of monuments in France by the state, was a huge success and was reprinted in 38 editions in under 2 years. Barrès and his friends were partly successful when in 1913 the Parliament declared a limited responsibility of the state for the monuments with the law of the 31st December 1913 about the monument, the historical monuments. The church, as the owner of the cathedrals, however, still had to carry the main burden. The shelling of Reims Cathedral by the German army occurred, therefore, only shortly after the majority of the French people, after long deliberations, identified with their national monuments and a law was passed for their protection. The confrontation around the preservation of and responsibility for France churches peaked at a time when a virtual cult about the French Gothic Cathedral and the era of Middle Ages had been formed around 1900. Praised as France's most important artistic and cultural achievement, the Gothic Cathedral represented the Middle Ages, now seen as the ideal era. Victor Hugo's Notre Dame de Paris from 1831, Wiesmann's La Cathédrale from 1898, elevated the Gothic Cathedral to be considered as more than a religious and architectural masterpiece, but rather to embody the nation itself. Especially instrumental was Emile Mahle's La Religieuse du XIIIe siècle en France, 1898, which contributed greatly to the new appreciation of medieval Christian art as a distinctly French creation. The book became to be one of the best and most important art historical contributions to the Renouveau Catholique. In this context, the violent public reaction against the Reims bombing becomes even more understandable. Barrès referred to the Cathedral of Reims as the most sacred monument of French history. His violent attack against German invaders is therefore comprehensible. When he wrote in September 1914, after learning about the shelling of Reims Cathedral, Sainte Cathédrale de Reims, toute mutilée, tu demeures aux yeux de l'esprit notre relique nationale. All of France seems to have been in mourning. The shelling of the cathedral was also understood by many as religious vandalism and an attack against the Catholic Church by Protestant Prussians or even Christianity in general. Similar to the reaction to the recent terrorist attack in Paris on the Charlie Hebdo magazine, the whole nation united in 1914 after Reims Cathedral was struck. Regardless of their political or religious conviction, the French stood together to defend their culture. They understood the attack not only as a military assault, but as an invasion to destroy their civilization. Even the utmost admirers of German culture withdrew their sympathy. A telling example is the French writer and dramatist, novelist, and essayist Romain Rolland, who was awarded the Nobel Prize during the war in 1915. Inspired by Indian philosophers, Rolland was a pacifist, did not adopt in the general war enthusiasm of his contemporaries. After years of teaching the history of music, he dedicated his life to writing, inspired by German literature and music. In 1913, he moved to Switzerland, where he published vehement articles after reading about the bombing of the Cathedral of Reims. Au-dessus de la mêlée, above the battle, published in 1914, is a lively and engaged manifest against war in general. He attacked especially the aggression of the German army against monuments, which he considered to belong not only to one nation, but to mankind in general. Because of the general nationalistic enthusiasm, his pacifistic convictions were not shared by others. Instead, he was aggressively denounced as a defeatist. After the shelling of Reims, he too accused the German army of vandalism. In a paper published in September 1914, he stated, "Notre France qui saigne, de tant d'autres blessures," you have that in English here, "so many other injuries, has suffered nothing more cruel than the attack against her patron, the Cathedral of Reims, Our Lady of Reims. He who murdered this work assassinated more than just the man. He assassinated the most pure soul of the race. He further detailed how he had received letters from soldiers who proclaimed that they considered the shelling of Reims worse than all their physical suffering in the trenches. This suffering is more than the suffering we do in our trenches, and we would like to give our lives to have Reims saved. This statement is not without propagandistic overtones. Even Roland let himself get carried away and declared that the French would sacrifice their lives for a historical monument, whereas the Germans would destroy it to save the life of one of their soldiers. This statement is, in other words, a definition of vandalism versus civilization. Roland even raises his language into a theatrical tone. Those who assassin, who kill Reims, kill more than, oh, that's the good question here. He who murders this work assassinates more than just a man. He assassinates the most pure soul of a race. Roland's allusion to the German intellectuals refers to the 93 German writers and artists and scientists who signed a manifesto titled An die Kulturwelt, written in protest of the international, especially the French press, reaction to the invasion of Belgium and the bombing of Reims Cathedral. The declaration, whose format relates to Martin Luther's 95 thesis published in Wittenberg in 1517, includes several absurd statements and also contains the phrase to which Romain Rolland referred. Every German would, of course, greatly regret if in the course of the terrible war any works of art should already have been destroyed or be destroyed at some future time, but inasmuch as in our great love for art we cannot be surpassed by any other nation, in the same degree we must decidedly refuse to buy a German defeat at the cost of saving a work of art. It is astonishing that even artists, writers, and art historians signed this text. Their signatures were definitely the result of the general propagandistic press reports and of censorship in Germany. Most of them, however, regretted their endorsement already during and after the war. Only few, such as Georg Friedrich Nicolai, professor of medicine at the Berlin University, and Albert Einstein, refused to sign. Nicolai instead tried to appeal to the intellectuals of all countries to make themselves heard and fight for peace. He especially cautioned that the conditions of a possible peace accord should not contain an incentive for future wars. Nicolai found a congenial partner in Romain Rolland, who published his declaration of independence of intellectuals after the war in order to pronounce the spirit of international reconciliation. The Manifesto Anti-Kulturwelt was published on October 4th, 1914, immediately after the shelling and burning of Reims Cathedral. The international press, and especially the French, responded acidly to the declaration. They attacked not only the tone and misinformation it contained, but, and that is characteristic, also stressed that German intellectuals went hand in hand with the military. The critics of the manifesto were appalled by how German artists, writers, or professors blindly followed the official military bulletins and uncritically and obediently supported the government and the Kaiser. The famous French historian Ernest Lavis published a fervent counter-manifest. The playwright Alfred Capus, editor of the Figaro, resumed the controversy against the German intellectuals. The notorious German intellectuals have brought shame to themselves in front of the entire world by declaring that culture is inseparable from German literature. Readers today would be astounded about the the very hard and sharp language of the absurdity of arguments on both sides. The famous French art historian Emile Mahler went even so far to say that Germans had never invented anything. Especially in the arts, he proclaimed that they only copied the French. You have here the quotation. In the realm of art, Germany invented nothing. Germany imitated the past, but did not create anything new. We can predict that Germany will not take advantage of the future. People who despise the law cannot give birth to the beautiful. He even proposed that because Germans knew the history of Reims, they wanted to destroy the cathedral where the French kings were crowned and Jeanne d'Arc is venerated as a national hero. Underlying his argument was that the predominantly Protestant Prussia was attacking Catholic France. In contrast, French images distributed as postcards, as you see here, propagated a spirit of victory. Jeanne d'Arc will triumph over William II. A deep disruption occurred in the European intellectual world, which since the 18th century had formed a community across borders, even in times of political struggle. Patriotic feelings had been compatible with a sense of cultural and intellectual community, whereas nationalistic and militaristic convictions were not. Right before the outbreak of the war, in the summer of 1914, the general patriotic feeling turned nationalistic in France. Differences between political parties no longer played a role. The shelling of Reims Cathedral was interpreted as an attack against French civilization. It becomes now clear why Germans were depicted as Huns and barbarians. The Germans reacted unanimously, defending themselves against aggressive accusation of deliberately destroying monuments and works of art. In 1915, the War Ministry in Germany published a report, Die Beschießung der Kathedrale von Reims, to counter the unfounded and spiteful accusations. They saw themselves confronted with documents and witnesses were pulled to substantiate the German claims of French military use of the cathedral. It also denounced the devilish plan to keep German prisoners in the cathedral to prevent further shelling and their cold-blooded murder by the French when attempting to escape the burning structure. First and foremost, the report claims the destruction of the cathedral was the French's own fault, as they had neglected to dismantle the scaffolding. Because the conviction of the two adversaries was so aggressive and aimed to humiliate the other, no understanding was possible. The war had to continue. It has often been said that World War I was a war of cultures, and there are very good reasons for this thesis. The innumerable caricatures and posters published all over Europe and the United States confirm this argument. The war of images continued during the fights and stressed cultural differences, drawing a distinction between German culture and French civilization. Stereotypes where their deep roots in the past became the prevailing motives of this image. Looking at these and other images in the exhibition, it is possible to distinguish several main categories of representation. I can only focus on some of them. However, even by contemplating only a few, you will see how artists applied traditional ways of ridiculing the adversary, methods which are still practiced today. Monsters are being out of proportion. They are bigger than normal humans and have more physical power, which they use brutally. they suddenly and unexpectedly appear out of the far reaches of prehistory. They are primitive, appear as strangers in a civilized environment, and kill like cannibals. The example of Les Sauvages is a telling image within this category. This half-naked wild monster with his club, necklace of teeth and moustache resembling that of Bismarck or Kaiser Wilhelm plays around with a poor, small French soldier and devastates the civilization to which he does not belong. Reims Cathedral is burning in the background. The text on the bottom states, nobody can say that our culture is not the most beautiful of mankind. Culture is spelled the German way and with one additional R, alluding to the German pronunciation. Culture attacks civilization in this message. Whatever the aggressor may have as culture, it is primitive and not civilized. The same concept is illustrated in an American poster from 1917 on view in the exhibition. This brutal gorilla with a Prussian helmet, of course, brings to mind images of American comics and film. Like other depictions from King Kong, the animal carries a helpless and unconscious victim in his left arm. In his right, he holds a bloody club inscribed with Kultur, with which he destroyed Reims Cathedral, which is depicted in the background. He is running toward us, threatening us. We should therefore enlist to help him back, to hold him back. The third character is Thor. He is a more sophisticated brute because his background is in antiquity and the early religious history of the Germans. Thor is the god who destroys with thunder, with his thunder club, whatever goes against his will. In the French Thor image, one can recognize a bomb flying in the air topped by a Prussian eagle crowned with a German spike helmet. Behind the bomb, in the clouds, stand a group of Prussian officers resembling angels in Christian iconography. Thor destroyed the monuments of civilization represented here by Reims Cathedral and killed the people who are not members of his tribe. The message is that Germans cannot be real Christians, for their barbarian past still courses through their veins. This type of cartoon characterizes German invaders as barbarians, who have not evolved since ancient times. Kultur is considered not as culture in the English sense of the word, but describes a primitive, early, wide period of mankind, a condition in which the Germans still remain, far from French civilization, which, in the spirit of the French Revolution, embraces progress and humanity, which should continuously evolve over centuries. Many characterists use animals to characterize the aggression of the German Kaiser, like the lobster on the top or the crocodile below. In the lower drawing, the crocodile ironically sheds tears while watching the allegory of civilization mourning the destroyed cathedral of Reims. Again, the antipode of culture and civilization. Some postcards purport that the German army was looting works of art. However, the Cathedral of Reims could not be taken away and therefore had to be destroyed. Often the German Kaiser himself is the goal of attacks in propagandistic imagery. The images attack his hubris and compare him to Nero, representing him as a berserk who is in the process of destroying the cathedral or contemplates with satisfaction the burning monument. Especially popular were postcards alluding to the historic role of Reims, which were disseminated across France during the entire period of the war. These images depict Jeanne d'Arc confronting the German Kaiser, signaling that German aggression will be revenged. Jeanne d'Arc will resuscitate and liberate France once more, just as she had done during the English occupation in the 15th century. These images stress the sacred character of the church as well as its role as a national monument. The attack is represented as an attempt to erase a historical past, an attempt that will ultimately be unsuccessful. These postcards were intended as encouragement for the French nation at war. They conjure the final victory to come, like this one, in which a female figure resembling victory ushers forward a French officer, both towering over besieged Germany. The postcard quotes Maurice Barrès, stating that all people will forever remember the attack on the cathedral. The attack on Reims released not only a flood of commentaries and images, it must be considered a historical event that deeply ruptured the relationship between France and Germany. In this cartoon, France is cleansed of all German cultural symbols. France desired an expulsion of all Germanic ideological inspirations and the purification of every aspect of German cultural influence. The French did not want to forget in the future. A society, souvenez-vous, remember, was founded to maintain the memory of the shedding of France, of Reims Cathedral forever. This society was active for several decades after the war. The Germans could not counter this. Here's another, two more posters. The Germans could not counter the French flood of images. They were never able to disengage themselves from the disastrous reputation the country gained after the crimes in Belgium and Reims. Only few propaganda images alluding to the bombing of Reims Cathedral were produced by the Germans, and they are not really caricatures. They are images that try to convince the viewer that French war operations had misused the church. However, the Germans invested another propaganda weapon, which eventually became one of the most important international institutions dedicated to the protection of monuments, the Kunstschutz. The protection of monuments created in 1914. For a long time, the German Kunstschutz has been perceived as a purely philanthropic initiative independent from all political considerations, which is a one-sided view. Participants in this initiative were celebrated as heroes because they risked their lives to guard, protect, and conserve monuments of any cultural background during and after battles. Their mission in 1914 to protect cultural heritage parallels that of the later American monuments men who were active during World War II and have been honored in recent publications and a movie. The Department of the German Kunstschutz was installed to confront the huge international protests after the burning of the Library of Louvain in Belgium and the Cathedral of Reims in France. The Germans wanted to answer the accusations by indicating that Germany respected and protected the monuments of invaded countries. They could even refer to the fact that this was done by professionals, namely Germany's most important art historians and architects. No other country participating in the war had a comparable institution. One of the most important cultural figures, whom you see here, in Germany, the director of the Royal Museums in Berlin, Wilhelm von Bode, instigated the initiative. He proposed to the government a commission by specialists who would act responsibly, advise army leaders, and initiate the necessary measures to protect or conserve any monument they would encounter during military action. An especially important role played Paul Klemen, the general conservator of the monuments in the Rhineland, who was appointed commissioner of the protection of monuments for the German Empire. This photograph shows him in uniform in front of an unidentified ruined church on the Western Front in 1915 or 16. The photograph was probably taken in 16. Klemen was appointed in October 1914. in October 1914, right after the bombing of Reims, a month after the shelling of Reims Cathedral. This immediate reaction demonstrates the intention to counter the general outcry in the international press about the attack of the cathedral. German propaganda intended to demonstrate that the treatment of monuments by the French was far from satisfactory. They could refer to the book recently published by Maurice Barrès, which you have seen, La Grande Pitié des Églises de France, criticizing the minimal investment by the French government into the conservation of their cathedrals and their cultural heritage in general. German propaganda had convincing arguments, since they could quote French requests to their government. In 1915, only 1 year after the bombing of Reims, a German publication was released that describes and compares the administration of monuments protection in Germany and France. This was the first product of the German Kunstschutz, in which French and German authors were brought together. The German editor did, of course, not ask French colleagues to send text in the midst of the war. He just included articles published earlier in this volume. The French contributions included authors like Maurice Barrès, with excerpts from his book, La Grande Pitié des Églises de France, just mentioned. The publication by the Kunstschutz likewise quoted also passages of earlier publications by Auguste Rodin and the famous critic Charles Maurice. A whole chapter of the book is dedicated to France's neglect of conservation since the separation of church and state. The book contains, however, another argument against the French accusations of German vandalism. The Kunstschutz book was supposed to demonstrate the enthusiasm and passion of German art historians for French art. The famous art historian Richard Weimar, a specialist of French Gothic architecture, wrote a paper on the topic, The Country of Cathedrals, in which he listed the German scholars who dedicated their scholarship to French medieval art, such as Ernst Gall, Wilhelm Pinder, Graf Fitzthum, et al. They all served in the army in Belgium and France. He concluded, ironically, despite so much enthusiasm and dedication to French art, we are accused of voluntarily destroying what the French have built. One telling anecdote confirms this German engagement for French art. As reported by the French, when German troops entered the city of Reims, a German officer, who was an art historian, invited the soldiers to a lecture and a guided tour in the cathedral. I have not yet found a document which would state his identity. It is, however, very probable that it was Ernst Gall, a specialist of Romanesque and Gothic architecture, who later served as an observer in balloons for the German intelligence at the front near the city of Reims. It might also have been the Count Georg Graf Fitzthum, a specialist of French medieval manuscript. The book ended with an advertisement of publications written by German scholars about French art, demonstrating the importance of scholarship on and passions for the art of the neighboring country. Klemen stated in these two volumes, he has given a very, very complete, exhaustive description of all the operations in Belgium with inventories, photo campaigns, and first structural protection initiatives for the monuments that had been damaged during the war. These activities were described in precise reports sent to the ministry in Berlin. Klemen also created lavishly illustrated large format publications in two volumes that was published right after the war in 1919. Although the war was over, readers could still witness a propagandistic campaign. In long passages, Klemen explained how important German efforts had been to protect the monuments in the invaded countries. He repeatedly stressed the French minimal engagement to organize an administration that would support the conservation of their rich cultural heritage. A long series of photographs demonstrated the destruction of medieval churches by the French army. This is the case on the left in the photograph, by the French army. Kemper did not claim that they were deliberately destroyed, but that the French military did not sufficiently care to protect their own cultural heritage, of the argument. The controversy between the intellectuals of the two countries continued after the war for decades to come. The Kunstschutz would become a major institution for the protection of monuments and a model for other countries. This institution was created in protest against the general accusation of German vandalism during the invasion of Belgium and France in the summer and September of 1914. The culmination of the denouncement represented the shelling of the Cathedral of Reims. Today, we still consider this attack a vandalistic and completely immoral incident. Even if the claim by the French that the Germans deliberately wanted to destroy this monument cannot be proven, the diverse manifestos on both sides reveal a gap of understanding so deep that attempts to find political solutions for this disastrous war proved futile. Also at this early moment of the war, the enemy still were convinced that victory was possible. But the worst was still to come. Only 1 year later, many signatories of the diverse manifestos on both sides regretted their participation in the controversial declaration. In the meantime, the fund had come to a devastating deadlock. The story of the shelling of Reims Cathedral is a fascinating historical moment that sheds light on the fatality of World War I. Intellectuals on either side would probably not have been able to avoid brutal military actions. Yet they failed to create a climate of reason and responsibility. The intellectuals were not unbiased and independent, but blindly followed the political propaganda on both sides. They identified not with patriotic, but nationalistic feelings and nurtured illusions of military and cultural superiority. Also in our discipline, the art historical discourse of this generation was arrogant and sometimes even ridiculous. Scholarly arguments were elided in favor of humiliating attacks. As historians, we can today confirm that the Kunstschutz was a result of a propagandistic initiative. It has, however, played a very important role in the past century. During World War II, this institution was an active and respected part of the military, even recognized by the French, who honored the head of the military Kunstschutz, the Count Metternich, with the highest order of the Légion d'honneur. The Cathedral of Reims, its destruction, conservation, and restoration regularly was in the spotlight. For example, when after World War II, de Gaulle and Adenauer met in Reims and participated in a moving ceremony of reconciliation at a church service. It was also a memorable moment in the relationship of the two nations when 3 years ago, in the celebration of the 300 years anniversary of its foundation, a German art historian, Willibald Sauerländer, was invited to deliver the main speech about the historical and art historical importance of Reims Cathedral. And most recently, a German artist, Inge Knöbel, designed the new windows for the cathedral, a huge honor from the French, and a testament for the German-French relationship. What can we learn from this World War I episode? Because artworks are embedded in a spiritual and cultural context, their destruction has a visceral effect. More is destroyed than merely a building, painting, sculpture, or manuscript. That is because many of the most important artworks are invested with the soul of a nation and represent a long tradition and identity. Art history is a discipline uniquely equipped to reconstruct and draw out these humanistic and emotional experiences and connections. Unfortunately, the world has not learned from past destructions of monuments and the physical and moral injury they cause. The many international conventions since 1907 have not stopped vandalistic events, as evidenced by the deplorable losses in recent and current wars. The shelling and burning of Reims Cathedral today is still a symbol held in the memory of the French, less so in the memory of the Germans, for obvious reasons. In the exhibition, this historical moment commemorates the devastating fate suffered by important works of art, national monuments, and locations of religious devotion during wars. Their attack or even destruction creates deep frictions and long-time wounds which are difficult to heal. Thank you for your attention.